Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
May his grace and peace be with you.
May he fill our hearts with joy.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whom truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them?" Then Peter began to explain it to them step by step, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' But I replied, 'By no means, Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' But a second time the voice answered from heaven, 'What God has made clean, you must not call profane.' This happened three times. Then everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very moment, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them, and not make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved." And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them just as it had upon us in the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God? When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life." The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Revelation of John. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God, and he will be his people, and they will be his peoples. And God himself will be with them, and he will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said to me, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And to the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
In the Last Supper, when Judas had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ. the name of God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier. Amen. When I was growing up, my paternal grandparents lived right next door, down a little hill. And when I was 16, my grandmother, who had been sick, died, and my grandfather was left alone. He was a quiet, reserved kind of man, and losing his wife, with whom he had been since he was 19 years old, and now he was almost 89, just left him distraught and helpless. And so my parents found a very nice lady who would come and drop by every day and do some housekeeping and keep him company, and that seemed to be going well. And 6 weeks later, he took that nice lady down to the courthouse and married her. Well, my father was just furious. He was furious at his father, and he was furious at the lady, and I'm sure he was also furious in his grief that his own mother had died. But he said to us, his wife and children, he said, "You are not to go down to that house and visit them. We are not going to go into that house." And my older brother went back off to college, and my mother, as far as I knew, never went down there. And I, being the obedient daughter, did what my father said. But I watched my second brother get up and take himself down to visit his old, sad grandfather. And he went down there more than once. And even at the time, and even more now, I knew that he was the only one of us doing the right thing. His example and that kind of the making of a decision and doing the loving thing is what I'm trying to talk about in the sermon today. And what I want to talk about is two themes that are in today's gospel. Love and glory. Jesus says in the gospel, "I'm giving you this commandment, love one another." And he doesn't just say it, he demonstrates it, he shows it. He washes their feet, he gives them the bread and wine, he teaches them, even though he knows that they're going to betray him and deny him and run away, but he acts out love. I think love, even though, of course, we know we're all supposed to be loving, love is a much more challenging idea than we seem to think day to day. I mean, first of all, we're just bombarded with the idea of love as sort of hearts and flowers. You know, Hallmark and sweet little TV shows where everybody just gazes into each other's eyes and it's all just wonderful, and we think, well, that's what love is. But that's not at all the biblical idea of love. And then we can go kind of to the other extreme and think of love as self-giving love, as just giving yourself away totally. You know, all these people out there have needs, so I'll just go out and fill all their needs. You know, becoming that the wrong kind of martyr or even a doormat. That's not the kind of love Jesus is showing. The love that Jesus is showing comes from free agency, knowing that I am a person in this world who has the choice to act, to make decisions and to act. Love always involves choosing and acting. And we see that so clearly in Jesus. We see that in the first reading that we read today too, the one from the book of Acts, which as we read it, it's an interesting story, but we don't really get the full impact of it unless we realize that what Peter did in going to visit that Roman centurion, Cornelius, going into his household, what Peter did was shocking. It was shocking. It was almost horrifying to the rest of the early Christians. I mean, Cornelius was a heathen. He had sacrificed to who knows what god. He was Roman. He was part of the army that was occupying their country and stopping a lot of their cultural practices and oppressing them. Cornelius was the kind of person whose house you did not go into, period. But Peter was asked to go in by Cornelius, and by God, he perceived. And so he chose and he acted. He went there. And not only did he teach them and speak to them and baptize them, but for heaven's sake, he spent the night with them. Several nights. He must have eaten meals with them. It was just amazing to the other disciples. But then they perceived God is acting in this, and Peter had done the right thing. So the other theme that Jesus is bringing up in today's gospel as he speaks to his disciples during the Last Supper is the theme of glory. He talks about being glorified and God being glorified. And again, the word glory in our general culture means something particular to us. It usually means triumph and victory and adulation and celebrity. We think of champagne bottles being poured over NASCAR drivers. We think of parades, you know, with teams that have won something. And if you're at home with my daughters and me, you think of the Oscars and people wearing $100,000 worth of jewelry in order to receive their award. That's what we usually think of as glory. But clearly, that is not what Jesus means. This is the Last Supper that when he's talking about this. He is about to be arrested and dragged off. He's about to suffer and die and be raised again. That is the heart of glory. And in John's gospel, it is particularly emphasized that death, resurrection, and ascension, which is the idea that Jesus is divine now, and we get it, he's with God. Death, resurrection, and ascension are one moment. John would not want us to separate them out. We wouldn't be having a discussion about the meaning of Jesus' death over here, and then 2 weeks later talk about the meaning of his resurrection. One of my professors liked to talk about it as a swoop. Jesus said, I will be lifted up, and he meant die, rise, and ascend. Whoosh. One big moment. And they have to go together. You can't have any part of it alone. Things that we may experience or think of as shameful or sad can be for God the beginning of that swoop of glory. So when I think about where we see love and glory in the world today, I think about my brother and the decision he made and the way he acted in love and in courage. And I think if God could shine a little spotlight to help us see where those glorious moments are, there'd be a spotlight shining on my brother as he walked through that gate toward my grandparents' house. And maybe you can think of other places that little spotlight to glory would be shining. I think a lot of people have talked about Vladimir Zelensky in Ukraine as showing us some moments of choice and action and courage and love. But there are plenty of other examples. Malala Yousafzai, Fuzzy, I've got her last name all right, who spoke out for girls' education in Pakistan, and the other young girl, Greta Thunberg, who spoke out about the needs of the ecological world and continues to do so, even though her parents still kind of roll their eyes. But she made a decision, and she acted on it in love. And you can think of lots of other places where God would be shining that spotlight of glory. I think of Ruby Bridges, who helped integrate the schools in Louisiana, and her parents as they ran that gauntlet of hatred. Surely God's spotlight was saying, glory, glory. Families who hid the Jews during the Holocaust. And as I was thinking about this, I remembered one day when I was a priest in Massachusetts, and we had an African clergyman who was traveling around, you know, trying to raise money in our diocese, and he came to lunch at my house. And after we were chatting for a while, he mentioned that he had been in Uganda during the period of Idi Amin. Some of you may not remember Idi Amin. It was just a terrible, violent, and capricious dictator. And this man who was sitting at lunch with me had been one of the people rounded up because the Anglican Archbishop spoke out against Idi Amin. And his clergy and the Archbishop were rounded up, trapped in a space together, and the Archbishop was taken off and executed. And this man sitting by me was ready to be next. He had chosen to stay in Uganda. He had chosen to speak out. But these are just a few examples. You can think of others, small ones in your own life, like mine with my brother, or these big ones that shine out on the world stage. So Jesus is inviting us to look for love. And when we're called to it, to choose it, and to take courage and act on it. And he's calling us to look for glory because there is glory. God glorified Christ, and he glorifies all those moments, big but also small, of choice and actions and self-giving love. And that is where we know the resurrected Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
gathered together in the name and power of our risen Lord, through whom the glory of God is revealed, let us offer our prayers to Almighty God, that heavenly peace may descend upon us and upon the whole world, saying, Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may love one another as Christ has commanded us, we pray to you, O Lord. That the church throughout the world and in this congregation may be united in peace, empowered by the Spirit, and faithful in its mission to all humankind. For Rob, our bishop, Michael, our presiding bishop, and Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, and remembering the staff of the Episcopal Church Center and the Scottish Episcopal Church, we pray to you, O Lord. That the power of Christ's victory over death may show itself among us, bringing freedom, joy, light, and life to those in need, remembering the sick and all who are in any need or trouble, especially Earl, John, Judy, Joe, Alice, Russ, Elaine, Marianne, Larry, Scotty, Bill, Richard, Tammy, Lyle, William, Jenny, Carrie, David, Catherine, Joanne, Ronald, Barbara, Dot, and Louise. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Watch over the people of Ukraine and all military personnel and their families. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We give thanks for all the blessings of this life. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who have died in the faith, especially Jim Brady, may serve as examples to us who continue in our earthly pilgrimage. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant, eternal God, that we who are made one with Jesus Christ in the power of his death and resurrection may show forth in our lives the love which proclaims us his disciples, that the world may believe in you and be saved through Christ the Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning and welcome to St. Paul's. Warm welcome to all who are visiting today. All are invited to come to our reception in the parish hall following the service. We'll warm welcome this morning to our guest organist, the Reverend Dr. Bill Weiser. So thank you. A couple announcements. We have a work day on Thursday. That's in your announcements, the various announcements. Both the gentlefolk of Noble Poverty and the St. Fiacre Guild are joining forces, and you don't have to be on either one of those to come and help out. So please do consider that. Tomorrow night here in the sanctuary, the Hoggard String Orchestra will be playing their spring concert at 7 p.m. We have our blessing box is bare. We do need items for that, and on your way to the reception you can stop by the table up the stairs and there'll be a sheet there telling you what kinds of things that you can bring for that ministry. At the reception also, we need to update our directory, and so you'll have the opportunity to get your picture taken by one of our lovely volunteers, and that's for the directory. We have a few announcements from parish life. Teresa.
Good morning. Thanks, Father Lee. We are bubbling with excitement. Once a school teacher, always a teacher. We are bubbling, let me do that one more time for effect, with excitement in anticipation of our parish picnic and plant swap next Sunday, beginning at 5:30 at shelter number 6 at Longleaf Park. We have an experienced crew of grill masters ready to fire up St. Paul's Grill and cook some burgers and hot dogs. We've got the sides, sweets, drinks. We've got you covered. No excuses, right? So all you have to do is show up and be prepared for some fun, led by the dynamic duo of Megan and Michael. And who doesn't love M&Ms? Get it? Megan and Michael, M&Ms. Even more to the point, who doesn't love prizes? So any way you look at it, we've got you covered. As for the plant swap, if you need to thin out your daylilies, dig out those saplings that have found their way into your garden beds, or divide your house plants, bring them to the picnic to share with folks that are hoping to green up their indoor and or outdoor spaces. We are still looking for some able-bodied folks to do some lifting and loading of tables, coolers, and other picnic needs at St. Paul's next Sunday afternoon at about 4:15. And as the bulletin announcement notes, I'll be at the base of the pulpit today to answer questions about our Sunday reception hospitality teams and sign up people who would be interested in serving in that ministry. So if you can help out with loading the picnic equipment, stop by and let me know. Who knows? There may be bubbles involved. Thanks.
Thank you, Teresa. You may have noticed in the news, a lot has been going on this week with the solar system, or discoveries about the solar system, or talk about the super flower blood moon tonight, which is will be total eclipsing at 11:29. I know we'll all still be awake at that point to see the total eclipse. But it got me thinking about how rare that is and how far away from us that is, but it's still a part of creation, still a part of God's creation. And then I got to thinking about, I mean, there's the moon, but then there's all the stuff going on with Mars and Elon Musk, you know, getting us there. If he doesn't back out of the contract, you know, no. Getting us there in 25, or you know, he says in very short time. But see, think about how far away that is. And then you think about our solar system and how really small we are, but still an integral part of of creation, and that's far out. That is so far out, right? But literally, exactly, far out. But then we got news this week of the first pictures of the black hole in the middle of our galaxy. 27,000 light years away, and one light year is 5.9 trillion miles away. And that is part of God's creation. That is far out. Right? That is far out. But there's something even further out than that. Right there. The type of love that Jesus has for us and the type of love that Jesus calls us to, as Catherine said today in her lovely sermon, that's the kind of love that Jesus calls us to. Far out. We're all a part of God's creation, all united in Christ. The whole universe saved by His love, God becoming man and saving us and calling us to that love. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave Himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation. In the calling of Israel to be your people and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with blessed Peter and blessed Paul and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ, who has nourished us with himself, the living bread, make you one in praise and love and raise you up at the last day. In the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of the risen Christ. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.